you have a 99% chance of never becoming a first-generation cash flow millionaire without this one secret skill. What am I talking about? I'll explain in this episode of The 7 Figures What Happening in 3, 2, 1. Let's go.
Never short-stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jeter. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger. Just fighting in them trenches, now I'm making 7 figures like...
What's cracking, everybody? Money Smart Guy Matt Sapaula here, hailing to you from Oak Brook Terrace, Illinois, a direct web suburb of downtown Chicago. And before I share with you the one secret skill set that will help you become a first-generation millionaire, let me share a little story here about our good friend, the Oracle of Omaha, Warren Buffett. At one point, he was asked, what was the one best investment that helped you make your money? What was the one greatest investment that helped you become not only a multi-billionaire, but one of the most richest men in the world? Is it Coca-Cola? Bank of America? Is it Apple? Even with his company, Berkshire Hathaway, owning over 2.3 billion shares combined of these three companies, his answer was neither one of these companies. In fact, the answer is framed up on his office in Omaha, Nebraska. By the way, you think it's his college degree? Not a chance. In fact, Warren Buffett credits his success of his one greatest investment to a $100 sales course by Dale Carnegie on how to sell, on learning how to be a communicator. He actually told the story of when he first purchased this course, that he was so terrified at the thought of speaking in front of people that he stopped his payment to get his money back. Could you imagine? Yo, appreciate the $100, but let me get my money back. Warren Buffett, imagine if he actually got a refund on his money and never learned how to be a great communicator and never learned how to sell and never learned how to speak in public in front of people. He credits his learning about investments and understanding about money and learning how to communicate with changing his life and having the biggest impact on his success. Now, what does that have to do with you being a first generation cash flow millionaire? Well, simple. You, my friends, have to learn how to sell. Why is sales such an important factor? Let's break it down. Let's unpack that right quick. Number one, being a great communicator, not just being a great communicator, being an excellent communicator helps you convey your point. And I love to watch pastors and comedians in their craft. Every Sunday, I'm looking at a pastor sell Jesus, sell heaven. I'm looking at comedians sell, which normally a very sensitive topic, but flip it so that's funny and humorous, and we actually see a different perspective and viewpoint. I love the way the greatest pastors, I love the way the greatest comedians have a great commonality in terms of being a great communicator, and they operate in that excellence to be able one of the top in their field. You gotta understand too, a lot of times is because they're great communicators, their ability to communicate increases trust. And think about this real quick. If you're a pastor, you're a comedian, you're a great, excellent communicator, what's more important, trust or likability? Huh? What's better, trust or likability? Many of you will say trust. Well, if I don't trust them, I'm not gonna do business with them. Correct. However, what gives you the ability to start trusting somebody? It's your ability to be an excellent communicator and convey likability. Because if people don't try to like you or try to be open to you, you know, have that likability in your aura, then the ability for them or desire for them to want to trust you is nixed. And therefore, you're back to square one. So think about that though. If you're able to create likability, you're able to increase trust. And we increase likability, you increase trust, and then guess what you're able to increase then? Speed. Because you're likable and you're trustworthy, guess what? People then say, you know what? I trust this person, and people are able to make decisions faster, handshake agreements are made much quicker, and you move on to the next phase of your business, of your endeavors, much sooner. The other part about being a great communicator, there's two different styles of being a great communicator. One is verbal, one is nonverbal. See, I was just communicating with you with my eyes. And it was left up to your interpretation. How many times have you seen the show, or have you ever seen the show, The Blue Man Group? I love The Blue Man Group. Take my kids when they're young, still take it to them when they're older. We have a blast. They change the shows around. The music is the bomb. The presentation, extraordinary experience that we have all the time. But how much words verbally do The Blue Man Group actually say during the whole Blue Man Group show? And I believe it's a show that's been around for over 20 years. And how successful had they been by communicating and entertaining, and people still buying tickets to the shows, not only just in Chicago, in Vegas, East Coast, West Coast, it's all over the place. They've created franchises of the Bloomer Group because they're able to communicate excellently through their style and art of music and entertainment. You know, one of the things that I learned very early on is a Marine coming out the military. My first instructor literally had me read a book called Green Eggs and Ham. He taught me how to slow down my speech, inflect my speech. He taught me how to use hand gestures. I don't know if it works with you or not. I don't know. It depends. You like me or you don't. But here's what he taught me: how to be me. And he gave me the permission to say, hey, Matt, as a communicator, you have to think about your audience. You have to think about how you're going to communicate with them. And you also have to be okay with knowing that you're going to be communicating heavily with an audience and resonating with that audience, but also embrace the fact that you just may not be hitting and impacting certain people too as well, and they'll be repelled by you. And that's okay. So you got to be able to understand, how do I find a way to unify if people don't like me for a reason, but for a moment though, can they still listen to me? And that's one of my biggest challenges, of being a person that wants to communicate. Because there's oftentimes, you watch videos, you've seen them before, the YouTube videos of politicians, the things that's out there that you like or you don't like, but still, because they're excellent in communicating it, even though they may be repelled by that message, they still listen to it. They still want to hear the other perspective, even though they may not agree. So one of the things that I learned there is just not only be an excellent communicator to people that like you, but also finding ways to communicate to people that don't like you. At least they can respect your position. The second part of being an excellent communicator is overcoming rejection. Oh my gosh. How many times do I have to deal with rejection? Over and over and over and over again. Here's a quick quote. Continuous training in overcoming objections and rejections gets 50% higher net sales per employee. That's why you want to be good at understanding rejection. Rejection and objections is part of the sales process, part of the entrepreneurial growth journey. Listen, if you're out there trying to communicate, not everybody agreed with Abraham Lincoln. Not everybody agreed with Martin Luther King. Not everybody agreed with Warren Buffett. But they're able to still get their message across. When you're looking at rejection, you got to look at it and say, you know what? How do I take that message, and does it challenge or compromise my values and principles? Does it challenge and compromise the things that I stand for? If they do, then you got to stick to your guns. And you got to find different ways to craft your message to still impact them using stories and analogies. So therefore, they're more receptive to hearing what you have to say. So part of the process and growth process of learning how to be an excellent communicator and how to incorporate a skill set is understanding rejection is part of the territory. One of the ways to beat this enemy of being fearful or taking rejection personally, you should actually take it professionally. And one of the things that that people have as an enemy towards rejection is a lack of confidence and a lack of knowledge about their subject matter. Here's what I love about this process. Who do you think gets the most out of a subject matter? The student that's learning or the teacher that's instructing and teaching? Who do you think gets more out of a subject matter? If you said teacher, you're right. Why? Because the teacher of that subject matter has to gather information, fact check it, gather information, fact check that, and find out ways to deliver it and practice it. And chances are they do it over and over and over. Different audiences, different cities and states. YouTube, online, offline. And guess what happens? They increase their confidence and they increase their knowledge because they're becoming thought leaders about that subject matter. And if you are an entrepreneur, guess what you end up having to be? You end up being a thought leader, a subject matter expert on whatever it is that you're selling or whatever it is that you're representing, and I hope that you stick with it for the long term. Why? Because if you start, stop, switch, guess what you have to do again? You got to start all over in mastering that new product, service, or idea, and guess what happens to your confidence when you first start? It's low and has to be built back up all over again. The other part of this is repetition. Repetition. Repetition, repeat. We always say this in our office, DPR, drill, practice, rehearse. Drill, practice, rehearse. Anytime we have a talk on stage, every time we have a talk in front of folks, in front of people, You want to do it 5 times, 8 times, 10 times, 15 times in practice. Because the last thing you want to do is present your subject matter in front of people and it's the first time you've ever done it. Or if you're calling on and making sales calls or you're following up, have you follow up? Have you practiced your sales script? Have you practiced your phone script? Have you practiced your approach and contact? Have you practiced your follow-up script? I mean, just a few minutes ago, we were going over a script for one of my associates here in the office about what her follow-up script is after somebody says, I'm ready to go. So we still have to drill, practice, rehearse. And how does that get done? And how does your confidence increase and your knowledge increase? By repetition. One of the unique things that we've done lately is have the opportunity to interview a lot of celebrities and A-list type folks like Kobe, the late great Kobe Bryant, like Tim Grover, the personal trainer to Kobe Bryant, Michael Jordan, Dwayne Wade, and having a cigar with Michael Jordan. I can't tell you how many times repetition, over and over, drill, practice, rehearse, they applied in their physical sport that later on in life they started applying to their mental sport, which is business, which is operating their craft outside of just being in the basketball court. But he started applying these things. We look at Tim Grover, what he's done to build a personal training business after training 3 NBA champions over and over and over again, what he's done to recreate himself by seeing guys in baseball and basketball and bodybuilding. It's a mental sport. And how he authored the book Relentless, where he talks about all the different attributes that makes one relentless. And if you see his rules, one after one after one, there's not one rule, second rule, third rule, all number one. Is relentless about that, relentless in repetition. You've heard the stories about Kobe Bryant practicing at 2 o'clock in the morning, getting back after again, 3 o'clock in the morning, still practicing and making his shots. You've seen the times that Michael Jordan relentlessly competed in practice, because they say we can perform in practice and repetition. We can increase our confidence in practice. We can increase our knowledge and our ability to run these plays in practice. And part of the process, it's going to be easy in the game. But a lot of people don't want to do that work, but yet they want to be great. It doesn't mix. It doesn't match. And if you want to consider having an opportunity for you to one day become a first-generation cash flow millionaire, this one secret skill set is actually wrapped in this thing called work. So consider that in your process. The third thing in terms of that one secret skill set is this: your ability to persuade and influence. That, my friends, is sales. To be able to find ways for people to look at your perspective, but not bullying them, but not forcing your way, but not having to speak louder, but by persuading them with facts, calm, tone, not rubbing people's egos, and learning how to influence long after the talk is over. Now, oftentimes you'll be in a debate, and you may lose one or two, but listen, we always tell who's right with two things. With the fruits of that labor, who's bearing the most fruits? Who's got the most success? Who's got the most profits? Who's got the most output from their thought process, from their strategies? And the second one is time. Because they may be winning now, but do they win over a 6-month period, a 1-year period, a 5-year period, 10-year period? And when you're looking at these leaders, like Martin Luther King, when you're looking at Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, what do they have in common? They changed the world. One helped found the United States of America. The other led through a civil war and reunited the nation by abolishing slavery. Another fought civil injustice and changed the lives of millions and millions of African American citizens. Zoom out and think about what they had to do to rally others and what they had to do. What about the monumental tasks they had to accomplish? Now zoom back in and think about you becoming a first generation millionaire. All of a sudden, the goal doesn't seem as unreachable, but it'll still require tough, hard, committed work over an extended period of time. I don't care about one's short-term wins. I don't care if you win this battle, you win this battle, this battle. I care whether or not you have a strategy that will stand the test of time. And if you want to be a first-generation cash flow millionaire and then pass it on to the second, third, fourth generation, these are definitely one of the things you want to be thinking about. Bottom line, you know long-term you're going to need help. Your communication skills need to be able to move people towards a common goal. Let me wrap it up with this great short story about Lincoln's forgotten speech. What am I talking about? Lincoln's Lost Speech was a speech given by Abraham Lincoln at the Bloomington Convention on May 29th, 1856 in Bloomington, Illinois. Traditionally regarded as lost because it was so engaging that reporters neglected to take notes. The speech is believed to have been an impassioned condemnation of slavery. There are no known transcripts or written accounts of the lost speech other than a brief summary in the local press. Talk about leading, persuading, influencing. I'm thinking about this lost speech. I'm thinking that the reporters were looking at him with their mouths wide open, right? About writing with their pens and their notepads and completely forgot to take notes. My friends, that's influence. That's persuasion. That's understanding even though people don't agree with you, you still find a way for them to listen to you and to still respect you. And then on top of that, you communicate with excellence, not just a substandard, let me just shoot from the hip, but preparation and understanding what you're about to deliver means the fact that you can move people in a very big way. Three questions I want you to ask yourself as I wrap up. Ask yourself question number one. How would the art of mastering communication change your life? Where do you think you'll be in life by having the power to excellently communicate with others? Number two, what's your game plan to get there? Do you have a step-by-step duplicatable process? And number three, do you have somebody in your corner to teach you and guide you and to help you avoid a lot of mistakes that you otherwise would have made without somebody in your corner? Who do you have counseling you in your decisions? Now, if you don't have somebody in your corner, you don't have a blueprint, you don't have a step-by-step strategy, that's all the more reason for you to consider subscribing to our YouTube channel here at 7 Figure Squad by clicking on the subscribe button and hitting notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. A couple of videos I want you to check out if you finished this video up until this point. Number one, it's One Secret to Closing. Check this video out, One Secret to Closing. And the second video is a live video of actually me closing a deal. You actually watch me in person, live with somebody that called me up and said, I want to do some things, and I having a conversation with them online on the phone. Watch this video and watching me close a deal live with a real prospect. That being said, if you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like and follow our business page, Mighty Smart Guy. And again, if you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe and hit notification to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode so you don't miss an episode of the 7-Figure Squad. That being said, more power to you here in 2021 on learning this one secret skill set so therefore you could become a first-generation cash flow millionaire. That being said, I'm your Mighty Smart Guy, and until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be mighty smart today.